Predators by Linda Hogan. I cannot smell the scent of the cat who slept on this sweater. But do know how the garden swells with old and pungent herb art. In the sun, the fox bows to my feline and their good dog friends. Who rule this land? I who and cultivate. Find my dead aim in the trust that many tales spun in this tract long before I came. The dogs do not understand wild nature. I also was domesticated. Oh, give me strength to watch their sorry looks, as a bevy of vixen feed on a much smaller body. Not the cats, but it could be. Hello everybody, today's lesson will be poetry. The title of our poem is Predators. And the poet who wrote this poem is called Linda Hogan. Dears, before starting our lesson, let's discuss together the objectives of the lesson. The objectives of our lesson. By the end of this lesson, you will be able to. Number one. Identify any irregular poem. Number 2. Analyze its component parts. Number 3. Predict its theme or author's message. And finally, you will be able to identify the figures of speech and the sound devices. Before starting our poem, it is very important to know some information about the poet herself, Linda Hogan. Linda Hogan was born in 1947. She is an environmentalist, poet, storyteller, playwright, and novelist. Look at her photo, dears. Actually, she is an award-winning, and also she is a Chickasaw novelist and poet. Her writings often addresses topics such as what? Guess. Such as the environment and the Native American history. She is an activist, speaker, and educator. Here are two photos in front of you. Which one has predators? Are the dogs predators? I want to hear your answer. No, of course, dogs are domesticated or tame animals. What about tigers? Are they predators? Yes, of course, they are predators because they are wild animals. Have you asked yourself before what is the genre of this poem? Yes, it is a free verse irregular poem. What about the form and the structure of this poem? It is a free verse, a regular poem of 15 lines, written in 4 stanzas. Stanza 1 consists of 4 lines and it is called a quatrain. Stanza 2 also consists of 4 lines, a quatrain. Stanza 3 consists of 5 lines and it is called a quintain. Stanza 4 only 2 lines and it is called a couplet. Moving to a different point, what is the setting of this poem and as you know, setting includes time and place. The setting of this poem is in and around the speaker's garden during the day. What is the theme of this poem? The eternal conflict between domesticated and wild animals. Who is the speaker of this poem? The speaker is the poet Linda Hogan herself. Now, let's start analyzing the tone of this poem. This poem has a suspicious, serious, and mysterious tone. What is the background of this poem? It is about the loss of habitat. Do you know the word habitat? Yes, natural environment is a major threat to wildlife. Essential question: how do humans and domesticated animals interact with wild animals when their paths converge? What about summarizing the poem? The speaker was working in her garden using a hoe, which is a garden tool. Why? To get rid of the pungent herbs surrounded by her feline, her cat, and her dog friends. Suddenly, she noticed a bevy or a group of vixen. Vixen are female foxes. Looking at her cat while eating an animal nearly the same size of the cat, both the cat and the dogs were very afraid and worried. Now, dears, let's imagine the scene together. The speaker, the poet Linda Hogan, is working in her garden using a hoe, a garden tool. Why? To get rid of the pungent herbs or the bad smelt herbs surrounded by her feline, her cat, and the friends of the cat. The friends of the cat are dogs, by the way. Both the cat and the dogs are domesticated animals. The garden is surrounded by a fence. Outside the fence, the speaker noticed a bevy of vixen, or a group of female foxes, eating an animal nearly the same size as the cat. The cat started to be worried. The dogs also started to have sorry looks. The foxes kept looking at the cat and bowing for her, tempting her to come outside the fence. Actually, foxes do not eat cats in their natural habitat. But what do you think, dears? Is the speaker's garden a natural habitat for foxes? Of course not. So anything may happen. So the vixen may eat the cat. This is why the cat is worried, and also the dogs are very worried about her. Let's draw a comparison between domesticated animals and wild animals. Domesticated animals include the cat and the dogs. They live inside the house of the speaker, while wild animals are the bevy of vixen, and they are supposed to live in their natural habitat, in forests, for example. Let's move now to the figures of speech found in this poem. The first figure of speech found in this poem is a metaphor. Do you remember what is a metaphor? It is a comparison between two unlike things without using as or like. In the line, "The garden swells with old and pungent herbs," this is a metaphor because the poet compares the garden to a swollen balloon. The poet compares the garden to a swollen balloon. The second figure of speech is also a metaphor, and it is found in the line, "The trust that many tales spun." The poet here compares the tales or stories to something that can spin or revolve around another thing. The third figure of speech is a personification. In the line, "In the sun, the fox bows to my feline," the poet personifies the fox as a person who can bow to the poet's cat, as you can see in the photos. The fourth figure of speech is also a personification. In the line, "My feline and her dog friends who rule this land." Here, the poet personifies her cat and dogs as kings and queens who rule the area where they live. The next figure of speech is also a personification, and it is found in the line, "My dead aim." Here, the poet personifies her aim as a dead person. Another personification can be found in the line, "Many tales spun." Many tales spun. Here, the poet personifies the tales or stories as spinners. Do you know the meaning of spinners? Spinners are people who spin threads. They change the raw material into threads. It is a profession, dears. Now, let's have a look at the images, imagery, or sensory language used in this poem by Linda Hogan. In the line, "I cannot smell the scent of the cat." Scent means smell also. Here, the poet uses sensory language through the words smell and scent that appeal to the sense of smell. The second image is found in the line, "and pungent herb art." The word pungent means having very bad smell. So the poet here uses sensory language through the word pungent that appeals to the sense of smell. The next image is found in the line, "to watch their sorry looks." The poet uses sensory language through the words looks or sorry looks that appeal to the sense of sight. Now, I'm going to illustrate to you the different sound devices used by Linda Hogan in this poem. First, alliteration. Do you remember what is alliteration? Alliteration is the repetition of the first consonant sound. In line 1, we have the words smell and scent. Smell, scent. Can't, cat. Can't, cat. In line 2, we have the words slept, sweater. Slept, sweater. In line 8, trust, tails. In line 10, dogs, do not. In line 12, strength, sorry. In line 15, cats, could. And in line 15 also, but, be. Repetition is another sound device used by Linda Hogan in her poem Predators. The word cat is repeated in lines 1 and 15. And the first person pronoun I is repeated all over the poem, because this poem is narrated from the first person point of view, first person perspective.